睇起上都好快手啊，幾分鐘搞掂。好，咁我
All right, I believe the problem has been fixed, so we shall resume. Date of the next meeting and items for discussion. It will be held on the 10th of July at 10:45 a.m. That will be the final meeting of the panel this term. Items for discussion, please refer to the list of outstanding items for discussion. We shall now invite the administration in. We shall first invite the secretary and his team in. The government proposes the following discussion items at the next meeting. First, progress of the study on the proposal on oath taking by civil servants. That is the first item on the list of outstanding items. And the second item, anti-epidemic fund 2.0, job creation scheme and matching grant scheme for skills upgrading, which is the second item on the list of outstanding items. Before I open up the floor for questions or comments, in terms of the political neutrality of civil servants and staff of subvented organizations, many members ask whether this could be discussed since the next meeting will be the final meeting of the term. The secretary suggests that the issue of political neutrality can be discussed in the first item next time. That is a proposal on oath taking by civil servants. That is the ninth item on the list of outstanding items. That way, we will be able to cover this discussion in the last meeting. Mr. Lam Chiak-Teng. Thank you very much for arranging this discussion item for the next meeting. If the chairman and secretary agree to the discussion of this item, then we should cover more than the progress of the study on oath-taking. We should discuss the progress of the study on political neutrality of civil servants. That means we should cover both issues next time. Secretary, is this possible? The study on the proposal on oath taking will touch upon the issue of political neutrality, but I believe we can cover that if we want to. Any other questions on the proposed discussion items? So we are going to have three discussion items next time. Chairman, Secretary, these would be two separate discussion items, right? So what the Secretary meant was that the item could be incorporated in item one, all right? Agenda item number three, 2020-21 civil service pay adjustment. Please refer to electrical paper CSBCL/PG/4085001/85. And also LC paper number CB(4699). Two deputations sent in submissions at CB(4724/19-20)01 and (02). They were submitted by the Government Discipline Services General Union and Hong Kong Civil Servants General Union. All LESCO members were invited to this discussion session. Since the 2020 to 21 civil service pay adjustment decision had no financial implications, the administration does not have to submit any proposals to the Finance Committee. According to Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure, if members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests on the items to be discussed today, please disclose the nature of such interests before you speak. Would the secretary walk us through the paper, or shall we open up for questions? I would offer a brief introduction. We submitted a brief on the 2020 to 21 civil service pay adjustment, and first of all, declaration of interest. The Executive Council decided on the 2nd of June that the pay for civil servants in the upper, middle, and lower salary bands and the directorate shall be frozen with its retrospective effect from the 1st of April this year.
Now, in making such a decision, the CE in Council, as before, has considered thoroughly all the relevant factors, i.e. the six factors, the net pay trend indicators, state of the Hong Kong economy, changes in the cost of living, the government's fiscal position, the pay claims of the South Side, and civil service morale. And the paper has listed all these considerations for you. Now, I understand for civil servants, the pay freeze will lead to disappointment. But allow me to emphasize that after the CE in Council has made a decision, a letter has been sent to all employees that this procedure is really very much like before. We have considered everything and we have not deviated from the past mechanisms. Now, the decision was not easy because we have the net pay trend indicators were all positive, and then the cost of living is also in the positive, but we have considered the economy, cost of living, and the shrinking of the economy, a rise in unemployment. The latest figure is 5.9%, and of course the government's fiscal position. Now, we know that the deficit is going to reach 280 billion. So it was not an easy decision, and we hope members will understand. So this is really just my very brief introduction, and I'm happy to take questions. So thank you. So members, 5 minutes, okay, including both Q&A, starting with Mr. Chan. Now, first of all, I declare I'm a member of the Standing Committee on Civil Service Pay. Now, the paper says that six factors have been considered, PTI, state of the economy, changes of cost of living, government's fiscal position, the pay claims of the staff side, and civil service morale. Now, if you look at these six alone, most are supportive of increase in pay, but then the government decided to have a freeze. So we'd like to know whether the government has attached more weighting to any one of them, and whether this is a special case this time. Now, okay, we're going to have a pay freeze this time, aside from the determination of the mechanisms. Now, but if you look at the private sector, it seems to me that the pay trend survey for next year is also going to be negative. Now, but for morale, then it's going to be pay freeze. So the mechanism would suggest that you are not looking at the net pay trend indicators, and people will begin to doubt the validity of this mechanism. Maybe this is already out of date. Now, a pay freeze, now if you look at Appendix D, would not apply to subvented or contract staff, and you would not apply this to subvented bodies. But would make adjustment based on other factors. Now, you have now made a decision on the civil service, but what about for the subvented bodies? Will that have a knock-on effect on their employees? Thank you for your question, Mr. Chan. Now, of the six factors, some have an objective criteria, for example, the net pay trend indicators or changes in the cost of living. But for staff morale, well, you have some sort of measurement as well. But not all of them can be used as some sort of algorithm or arithmetic. So we are not going to look at them in a very rigid or mechanical way, because every year is different, and we look at the situation as it comes along. Now, on the private sector, now we know that they also face a difficult situation, and we hope that the economy will bounce back ASAP. So when the time comes, we will look at the result of the pay trend survey. Now, I cannot foresee what the future looks like, but if you say that there might be 1 or 2 years that we don't really follow the pay trend survey, this is something the mechanism allows. And in the last 28 times for the PTS, there were 9 times the government did not follow the survey, and those were special times, and we are now facing a special time at the moment. Now, thirdly, on the subvented bodies, well, they have their own autonomy deciding on their pay scale, so they really make their own decisions. They have some sort of a one-off grant, and they can have their own decision. Now, if we follow the pay freeze, there will not be additional funding for those bodies, and it is up to those bodies to decide whether to have any salary adjustment. So this is how the division of the issue works. We now have Mr. Poon Siu Ping, please. Now, we heard from the government that we have the six factors, and the result is a pay freeze. Now, for civil servants, especially the lower ranking civil servants, they will be very disappointed. Now, the government is the largest employer, and many companies look to the government. Now, profit-making companies, they look to the government, and not to mention the loss-making companies. Now, this time we have the net PTI in the positive, and yet we are going to have a pay freeze. Now, next year, if the economy is not ideal, there might be a possibility of a pay decrease. So I think that works against the morale of the civil service. But what we are discussing today is not going to change anything. In the past, the CE in Council may consider our views, but this time round, I guess it is useless for us to say anything. But no matter what, the government should look at how to boost staff morale. Now, we still have social actions, and particularly the police force, and then the medical staff. Okay, they have contributed a lot, but then they are told that they're not going to have any pay increase. For subvented bodies, they look to the government, and I don't think any of them would dare to increase salary. So we are looking at a knock-on effect all the way to other bodies. Okay, you say that you have a mechanism, but now you can adjust it any way you want. And all the net figures were positive, and yet we are not going to have any pay increase for the civil servants. Now, you say that there is a factor called the pay claims of the staff sides, and almost all of them have given their claims, except just one. So are you going to use this mechanism? And what is the use of having all these requests for comments from the staff sides? Now, for civil servants, especially the lower ranking ones, their morale has to be boosted, their work has to be recognized. So I hope the government would respond to this, please. Thank you, Mr. Poon. Now, in our decision today, we understand the civil servants, especially the lower ranking ones, when they hear about a pay freeze, they will be disappointed. And of course, the challenge we're facing is really serious, and we have plans to safeguard employment. We have this ESS scheme, but it doesn't really affect the civil servants because we're not going to lay off anyone. So now, as in the past, we listen to the PTSC as well as the claims from the staff sides. And on the 28th of May, we met with them individually. We received their submissions, and we have presented their claims wholesale to the CE in Council so that they can make a decision. And we will continue to use this way of handling the issue. Now, on staff morale, of course, pay is one factor. The other aspects include review within the overall structure, and we are looking at how these changes can be made, and including improving the work environment so that their work is more smooth. And thirdly, of course, we recognize the performance of the staff, especially during the last few months. The staff members have really guarded their posts, and they have worked very well, and we certainly hope that the policy implemented would suit members of the public. And of course, the LegCo is running smoothly, so I mean everything is being done well, so I hope that is also a factor. Now, okay, now Mr. Mok, now in the last 20 years, there were only two times of pay freeze, and it was with a negative PTI of 1 or 2 percentage points. But this time, the net PTI is positive. Now, is this the first time ever that we have a pay freeze under this sort of situation? Now, we received from civil servants, including the general civil service. And now the pay freeze is based on political considerations and hurting the morale of the civil service and also from the disciplinary services. Now we now have an economic downtrend. The government should really stimulate spending. But this is a relatively stable job, and if you freeze their pay, they don't spend. If you give them an increase, they would spend more and stimulating the economy. And of course, the Chinese Civil Servants Association also asks for a freeze of, 3 years. Now, is it the case that you have listened to the Chinese Civil Servants Association and freeze the pay for 3 years? Now, this should be clarified. Now, what about the private sector? Their pay is linked to the government's pay. If we freeze, they would decrease. If we add, then they would not decrease so much. Now, if you freeze the pay now, the private sector would follow suit. They will have a much bigger margin of decrease. So when the economy bounces back, it will slow down the growth in the private sector pay increase. Oh, wow.
Thank you. In terms of the decision, the chief executive in council made the decision not out of political consideration, but for the six factors mentioned. And they would consider the objective data before making a final decision. And they value the views offered by the staff side, and all their views were considered by the chief executive and council. The pay offers for civil servants would somewhat affect private sector pay and vice versa, but in our consideration, we only considered the six relevant factors. We did not consider the repercussions in private sector pay. All we relied on were the six factors. When we look at past data, there were instances is that if the net indicator was negative and we froze pay, and in 1999 to 2000, we had negative values for the upper and lower salary bands, but a positive value for the middle band, and the decision was a pay freeze across all the three salary bands. For recommendations offered by different consultative councils, they were all considered, and the CE in council's decision is not on any specific council. We considered the six relevant factors, and under the pay adjustment mechanism, we would consider the factors every single year, so we would not be making decisions for the next few years yet. Mrs. Regina Yip. Chairman. Like the Secretary said, the Executive in Council would consider the six relevant factors. Well, I hope the Secretary would emphasize the fact that the government would not be slashing the salaries, even though the current situation is even worse than the past financial crisis. In the short run, the government would not consider legislating for a pay slash, and the for the lower salary band, the gap is only 1.15%, which is not a lot of money. Many SMEs and businesses are suffering, and many people have lost their jobs. So the government would consider the overall circumstances of the economy. What about the GSR exercise for disciplined forces? Can you promise to never legislate for a pay reduction? And what is the progress of the GSR? For healthcare professionals, the government invested a lot of money. I believe a lot of the 4.7 billion goes towards wages. In terms of civil service, Mireille, as the head of the civil service, well, I asked Mr. Yu Kin Yun, for teachers, apart from money, how can you improve morale? It's not all about money. In terms of raising staff morale, money is not everything. In terms of, well, have you considered reinforcing the sense of commitment among civil servants, including teachers and healthcare workers? Thank you very much. I think everyone can see that the state of the economy is challenging. And in terms of the development of the epidemic and the repercussions on the economy, these are all causes for concern. Many companies have folded, some have laid off staff or cut wages, and that is why the government had to launch the employment support scheme. The point is to safeguard our businesses and retain jobs. So when we consider the civil service pay, we would consider the six relevant factors and look at relevant data. But when we arrive at the overall decision, we must consider civil service morale and the fact that civil servants are also a part of our society and we are all on the same boat. So there are expectations from the society on how we strike a balance. So the decision of a pay freeze has taken into account all the relevant factors, including the views of the staff sides. We did not, we are not going to reduce wages, which would require legislation. And as such, I consider a pay freeze appropriate. Of course, some civil servants might be disappointed, but we would have to consider the challenges we are facing. In the first round of the anti-epidemic fund, funds were made available for healthcare workers and the health and the hospital authority, which would support their epidemic control work. As for the GSR exercise for discipline forces, it is currently underway. over the past year, because of the epidemic, the committee's work endured certain challenges, but work has already resumed. We would certainly expedite the work and come up with recommendations. In terms of civil service morale, there are several aspects we are looking at. First of all, the sense of meaning and responsibility in our work. In this regard, we would do more. And in terms of the remuneration, benefits, etc., and also the work environment. Even if I'm committed to serving the public, if the work environment is not ideal, morale would certainly be affected. So we are looking at different areas. At the end of the day, communication between all sides is important, and this is something we would reinforce. Did the Secretary answer Mrs. Regina Yip's question? Would you promise not to legislate for a pay reduction? The pay adjustment exercise would take place every year, and the decision is made by the executive in council. So we would analyze all these data and factors before submitting such data to the executive in council. So it would be hard to make promises for the future. But what is certain is that we must take care of the civil service morale and the fact that civil servants are also a part of society, and how everyone can stand united in face of challenges. Mr. Tony Chair, thank you. I declare that I am a member of the Standing Committee on Discipline, Services, Salaries, and Conditions of Service. I believe the pay adjustment decision was a difficult one, but having considered the economy of Hong Kong and in the foreseeable future, we will face further challenges. Like the Secretary said, of course, civil servants would not be against a pay rise, and this is perfectly understandable. Well, the Secretary mentioned that communication is important and that improvements would be made in other areas despite the pay freeze. In the last few years, we visited some government offices. The environment is not ideal in many cases in terms of the seats and facilities. I believe the chairman would agree that enhancing the facilities would be conducive to the work of the civil service. During the epidemic, some people had to work at home, but the support and facilities were inadequate, and many civil servants felt dismayed. So in this regard, I hope the Secretary would do more. I believe this is a form of investment. Training is also necessary. And there should be relevant support policies. For instance, some more places for training and visits. so that civil servants who receive training would not have to deal with loads of work when they return. The net indicators are positive in the current pay adjustment exercise, but yet pay was frozen. So in the future, you should consider the commitments of civil servants or their contributions. I agree that communication is important and necessary. I hope you would meet the civil service unions in a regular manner. The task is certainly difficult, but it is essential. You would only find out about their needs once you meet them. Many civil servants have to go through very complicated procedures in their work. And you would have to work with relevant departments in order to really follow up on these views. Secretary, can you promise to communicate and meet the relevant civil service unions You should follow up on their views and suggestions, and I hope this is something you would promise.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Okay, we're going to have pay freeze this year, even though the net PTI is positive. Now, we conduct the exercise every year, so by this time next year, we will also be looking at the six factors. And we will look at the prevailing situation then. So it's going to be a comprehensive consideration. And of course, I thank you, Mr. Chair, on your point about stepping up communication. This is something we have been doing, but we will do more. And meeting with the pay unions. And of course, I've taken up this post less than 2 months, but I have met with the unions quite a few times, and I visited different departments already. And of course, I had the chance to speak to quite a few of them. I visited the police, for example, and talked to staff officers at different ranks. And there are issues of interest that I followed up on, and I kept discussing with them. And for example, how to make better use of technology to help. So this is an area of interest. This is something that can boost efficiency. Now, in the last few months, because of the pandemic, staff in different departments, they all work towards the same goal. And they have seen, provided a lot of commitment and working really long hours. And I'm really impressed. I think we have a really professional team of staff members. Okay, second round. If you are interested, please indicate so. Now, I would like to ask, now, there's one government body and sent us an email saying that a pay freeze with a positive net PTI, they have indicated disappointment, and they asked the government to look at the issue again. And they've also interviewed the existing members, and 84% of the respondents indicated that we should follow the net PTIs. And 86% of the respondents said that the government should be consistent in using the six factors in suggesting the adjustments, and 73% of them wanted an increase of not less than 3%. So this is just the view of one government association. So my question for you, now, we have in front of us the CEIN Council's meeting, but are you going to revisit? Is there any chance of revisiting this issue? Because we are faced with a positive net PTI, and yet you want to have a pay freeze. Now, the net PTI, okay, there is a time lag. Now, how come you have a positive figure, net PTI? Because you're using the 2019 figure. But for the second half of the year, it was bad. The first half was quite good. And so you have a percentage of 1.something%. Now, you can see when we have the next net PTI, it's going to be very, very bad. Now, if that's the case, so can you, Secretary, start the care and concern action? In other words, go and visit them, listen to them, and listen to what they have to say about the pay freeze, and to do some groundwork to prepare for next year, because people worry about their morale next year. If the figures are not good, what is going to happen? Is it that they have to wait for the CEIN Council's decision before they know about the decision? Or can you first of all listen to them? Secretary. Now, the first point has to do with the PTI being positive, cost of living also positive, and we have a decision to freeze the pay. It's relatively rare that this sort of thing happens. But in the past, we also had a positive PTI, but the decision was not just to follow that, but actually add to that 0.5% on top of that. So as I said, there have been times when you have positive and PTI, and yet you have a pay freeze. So if you look back over the years, the decision was made based on the prevailing situation. Okay, following the mechanism is important, and this is what we do, but then we cannot just rigidly look at the figures. And the figures represent a time lag, that is true, because it takes time to do the surveys. But in the past, now we have modified the pay trend survey methods to shorten or to reduce the lag, but we would still have some sort of time lag. But this is a reference figure, and we also take into account other factors. Now, thirdly, on communication, yes, we will definitely continue, not just with the unions or associations, but also to individual staff members. This is something we will continue. And also, we are looking at civil servants this time. Now, the government as a whole, now apart from the civil servants, you have the politically appointed civil servants, including the secretaries and the CE herself. They have taken a pay cut and given up a month's salary. Now, for the politically appointed staff, now every July, they would follow the CPI BC. And basically, it's going to be a pay freeze, regardless of the positive PTI figures. So the government as a whole is responding to the situation. So we are in the same boat, as I said, and we are also members of the same society facing the same difficult situation. Thank you, Secretary. Now, the pay adjustment is going to affect staff morale, so hopefully by better communication, we can make up for that and to boost their morale. Now, any other members want to speak on this issue? If not, we will move on to the next item 4, employment of persons with disabilities in the civil service. And we've got papers from the government as well as from the Secretariat. Now, this January, we received from a member of the public, and he asked for a public hearing, and we have responded to that call. And the social welfare panel or welfare services panel is also invited to attend, and we've got 4 individuals saying that they want to take part, and they are not all here yet, but we will continue. And there is one other written submission. Now, first of all, can I ask the government officials to enter, please? Okay, please bear with us because the members of the public coming here to join us have different degrees of disability, so we have to be a bit more patient. Okay, I think we are all here. Now I have to let members of the public know. So thank you, first of all, for coming here to share your views. I have to remind you, Now, in front of you, you've got a headphone. If you want to listen to different languages, you can pick your language channel. 0 for the floor, 1 Cantonese, 2 English, 3 Putonghua. We've also got a hands sign interpreting. And if you have the need, please let our staff members know. And deputations, individuals, please understand that for a smooth operation of the meeting, you have to follow certain guidelines. Now, you cannot shout or make slogans or leave your seats and affect the meeting. So all these are written in front of you. So there is a notice for members attending LegCo meetings. And if you need any help, please ask our security staff or LegCo staff. I also urge members of the public to understand that all your submissions and so on is not protected by the special powers and privileges ordinance of LegCo. So everything you say, you have to be responsible for. So I now give you time to speak. I know you've come a long way, but I can only give you 3 minutes each. So please pay attention to that. Now, first of all, we have Mr. Mokka Hon.
To members of the panel and government representatives, as an individual with attention deficit disorder and autism spectrum disorder, my message to you today is simple. Interview policies, training programs, and stigma removal are keys for people with disabilities to be able to work in a dignified environment in the government. Let's start with recruitment. Information, cooperation partners, and facilities are keys to encouraging people with disabilities to consider careers in the government. Government departments can work with different disability groups to provide job-related information and relevant activities to people with disabilities to learn more about different government positions. The government can also make recruitment assessment criteria for government jobs publicly, available publicly so that people with disabilities know how different skills, attributes, and work experiences are prioritized in the recruitment assessments and on the job. Facilities matter as much as the government should adopt the best local and overseas practices for the recruitment of people with disabilities. It's equally crucial for people with disabilities to have their requests accommodated during job interview assessments. The next one is staff training. A comprehensive training program covering a range of disability issues should be compulsory for employees with or without disabilities to attend. Such training programs, I believe, will help civil servants better understand the rights of people with disabilities and the tools and accommodations empowering them to work. The last one is stigma removal. People with disabilities need a safe environment to disclose their status. What the government can do is to simplify the disclosure procedures, making it possible for people with disabilities to report their status directly to the personal section of the bureau. What are the benefits of a diverse workforce, such as hiring more people with disabilities for the government? Simply speaking, it makes business sense. The government can create a supportive and flexible workforce that is attractive to all applicants. With comprehensive training on disability, civil servants with leadership responsibilities can develop their people management skills and capability to understand different team members' talents. Effective deployment of each member can enhance the quality of services delivered to the general public. To conclude, being the largest employer in Hong Kong, the government should serve as a role model for employers across different industries in the city. I hope that you will consider my suggestions. Thank you very much.
Thank
you very much, Mr. Ma. Next. Ms. Fok Choy Ling. Good morning. we would like to speak for ADHD individuals. And for those with attention deficit and autism, applicants might require more color, visual, and audio support. So adjustments should be made in terms of the documents. Some colors and graphics could be introduced, and video explanations would help them more readily understand the work. Thank you very much. Number six, Mr. Tang Chit-Ping. Good morning. I have three main points to make. For persons with disability, I'm the convener of an association for an employment quota system for PWDs. In 2013-14, the percentage of PWDs in the civil service was 2.3%, and by 2017, the figure dropped to 1.7%. For new civil servants or newly recruited civil servants, it fell from 3,415 to 2,942, or a drop of 14%. And in 2013-14, the recruitment percentage was 0.9%, and by 2017, it dropped to 0.6%. I hope the government will tackle the issue. And in 2018-19, the percentage of newly recruited PWDs in the civil service was only 1.6%. I hope the government should take the lead in recruiting PWD applicants. As for the subvented organizations, they are given subsidy to purchase aids. So in term, when the government creates a 30-time limited jobs, PWDs, there should be a target on the recruitment of PWDs, for example, 2%. Finally, many public services have been outsourced by the government, especially those that require labor work. And the same goes for PWD positions. When contractors employ PWDs, sometimes the PWDs are deprived and they have been treated unfairly. So in terms of the out-contract services, the problem would be tackled. That way, the rights of the PWDs to work can be safeguarded. Next, Mr. Chu Man. I represent the dialogue in the Dark Hong Kong Foundation Limited. I have two points to make. First of all, we urge the SAL government to act as a role model. And the same goes for the government-funded public bodies. They should recruit persons with disabilities. Like Mr. Tang Chit-Ping said, there is real cause for concern. For years, we have been working with our business partners to foster an inclusive society. But while the efforts of the business sector and PWDs were admirable, the government has done very little. So everyone is caught by surprise and we are all disappointed. In recent years, the government has created internship opportunities for youth and students with disabilities, and this is something we applaud. We hope that the work would continue and more should be done. Finally, I hope the government invests resources and support should be extended to employers and PWD employees for internships . These counseling or support organizations can provide coaching to persons with disabilities as well as employers. That way, the employees and employers would be given support and in a position to be more successful. Mr. Yip Ka Ho, thank you very much. Mr. Chiu was correct. The government should treat all civil servants clearly, including persons with disabilities. The Labor Department has always encouraged the recruitment of PWDs among private companies through various PWD employment schemes to achieve a win-win situation for employers and employees. But there are no clear incentives from the government to encourage them to enter to take up civil service posts. So this would not help improve the mismatch of talents. In terms of the current recruitment policies on PWDs among the government, you can refer to the website of the Labor Department, and I wonder whether any changes would be made. The government should encourage those with special talents to join professional posts. For example, in the administrative wing, the Department of Justice, the Five Discipline Forces, the EMSD Planning Department, etc. In terms of benefits, apart from aligning the civil service fringe benefits, special benefits for civil servants with disabilities should be introduced. For example, by expanding the scope of medical benefits for civil service, including psychiatric services, and improve the verification system for healthcare benefit eligibility. For people who are already receiving various subsidies from the Social Welfare Department, for example, CSSA or Disability Allowance recipients, if they are recruited as civil servants, would they have to cancel or return part of the funds? Disability allowance and public subventions are both paid for by taxpayers, so I hope this would be considered. Thank you very much. Mr. Chu, I represent the Direction Association for the Handicapped. We are a self-help organization for the severely physically handicapped. Every year, we discuss the recruitment of the disabled in the civil service. The government are an equal opportunities employer, so they should disclose the relevant figures. In terms of the employment of the disabled, this has always been a serious issue. The government should explain the situation as the main stakeholders. So this should be the context of discussion. In 2013, the poverty report on the disabled pointed out that only 40% of the disabled adults were in the employment or in the labor force, and among these, 60% were unemployed. For the recruitment of civil servants with disabilities, the recruitment percentage has dropped every year. In this context, how can the government convince the public that your policies would enhance the recruitment percentage of PWDs? The government claimed that they are providing convenience to PWD applicants. For example, no short listing is required. But if the recruitment percentages or rates are dropping every year, you are not improving the situation. In terms of policy objectives, you talked about reinforcing or enhancing the capabilities of PWDs, but your work has failed. The government has talked about negative labeling and the need to avoid it. In terms of special measures for applicants with disabilities, would that amount to special treatment? The government had recruited the visually impaired to man the 1823 service. In terms of equal opportunities, you need to take affirmative or positive action in order to solve problems. So the government should not be citing negative labeling all the time. So a recruitment target of 2% should be set up by the government. Such target might not carry statutory repercussions, but at least you should let the public know about your target and commitment. Thank you very much.
Ms. Chen Kunjun, please. Good morning. I'm Chen Kunjun, Isaac. I am deaf and cannot speak, but I can communicate with writing. So I would like to say something for those weak of hearing. Now, I worked for IT company, but since March, I was not allowed to continue with my contract because the economy was doing badly. I'm now out of work. I have applied for many civil service jobs, postman, clerical officer, grade 2 workman, or grade 2 computer assistant. I would apply for any post suitable for me, and every time I was given an interview, and I use pen and paper to communicate with the interviewer, but every time I was not given the job. So is it the case that I cannot express myself clearly? I have applied as a computer operator grade 2. And this is very similar to what I did in the private sector. I feel that I am competent. So I went to the interview, but was not successful. I was not given the job. Now, my deaf friends told me that, okay, they wanted to have a sign language interpreter, but during the interview, the sign language interpreter was not provided. So for those who are, hearing impaired, we could not communicate. Now, for people such as ourselves, we hope that the largest employer, i.e. the government, can give us a chance to work. So during interviews, we can communicate better and we have an equal opportunity for work and to have some suitable adjustment and, if necessary, provide sign language interpreter so that we, the hearing impaired, can have an equal chance to speak. Just like today, we are helped by a sign language interpreter. Now, I hope that we can join the government as a civil servant. And in fact, this quota of assigning certain quota to those with hearing deficit took place in various countries, Germany and Japan and so on. So this really should be initiated by public bodies, including the government. And when this begins to run smoothly, then other private sectors can follow suit. So the quota for PWDs can increase from 2% and then increase upwards, because at the moment, the government is having about 2% for PWDs. And we hope that this can be a good start. Thank you very much. Coming back to Mr. Kwok Wing Kin, please. 3 minutes. Now, if you look at the figures, now the government claims to have hired 2,881 civil servants with disabilities. But in fact, many of them are in the disciplinary services, and they are already civil servants, and they became disabled while being a civil servant. So the newly recruited is very, very few. It accounts for 0.7% of the overall number of recruits. Now, what does that mean? It means that during interviews, as has just been said, if you have enough flexibility, you can help those with disabilities. Now, on the system itself, now, is this a quota system? Very good. Now, we have listened to both sides. Now, what the government is saying is that this will create some sort of a negative stigma. But this is not reasonable. We can remove this stigma. Now, even private bodies, if they hire a PWD, does it involve a lot of other ancillary measures? Now, the government, as the biggest employer, does have the resources to help. And if the government doesn't do it, nobody will follow. Now, okay, a quota to force you to hire a certain number of PWDs. Some people may think that this is unfair for able-bodied, but this is an education process, because you will see that many PWDs can work as efficiently as able-bodied, sometimes even better with when given some help. So we can, well, remove this negative stigma. And I hope the government would really stop delaying. Now, if you want to be appointed, you have to go through different hurdles and barriers. And the government is saying that if it's a clerical officer, if you go through the skills, they would be considered for interviews. But during interviews, do you have the necessary measures to help them? And to inform the interviewers, how do you assess the ability of the disabled? I think the government can do better. Madam Lam, thank you for coming. 3 minutes. Now, on PWDs, whether they are different from other people, well, they work and live in the same society, but they are not given fair treatment. they are always being stigmatized, and people think that they are not as competent. But I believe everyone has their own talents, and they are just trying to have a normal life like everybody else and work from 9 to 5 to have a reasonable work time to do the work that they can take up. If there are more people in the world, can be more accepting, even though they have some limits, they are quite able to work hard to prove themselves. They have their own talents. Now, for example, the Olympics for the disabled, they can really excel and can perform even better than some able bodies because they go through a lot of rigorous training, because they want to be recognized and that they are not different from anyone. So we mustn't judge them just by their outward appearance. We should try to understand what everyone is good at and to nurture them because they have ambition and talents. These are people we need. We should be able to accept them. We should be able to give them room for voicing their needs. Our society needs multi-talents, helping one another, so that everyone can perform according to their abilities. And this is the responsibility of the government. And members of the public should also be doing the same. We should be more accepting in order to be happier for everyone. We mustn't marginalize everyone because these people do exist. They are members of our society. They need to be recognized and that their dignity be respected. Of course, everyone's ability is limited, including everyone in the room. No one knows everything. Now, we have 9 members speaking already, and I will now ask the secretary to respond 5 minutes, please. Thank you, Chair. Thank you. The 9 members of the public representing yourself or the association and sharing your views and suggestions. Now, first of all, I agree that PWDs may have physical disabilities, but I believe everyone has his or her talents, and society should give them equal chance to prove themselves. They may need certain help, obviously. Now, in my past experience, I have been in touch with different members with PWDs associations. Some have their 4 limbs affected, but they still go to schools to share their views with youngsters at schools. And this is really impressive. And they can make a stronger impact than able-bodied people. Now, when considering how to hire or employ PWDs, now our direction is to look at the different categories of work and to allow them, as far as possible, to join. So that is our goal, and we want to have suitable policy to help the PWD applicants to apply for civil service jobs. And some of you have suggested that during the interviews, um, that they should be given interviews during the recruitment process, and then during the interview itself, they may need certain help, and we should be able to provide those help. Now, and in our application forms, we ask the applicants to declare whether they need special help or measures. So in our recruitment, we are doing something there, and we are looking at what other aspects we can do even better. Now, some have suggested that there are certain requests made but not provided, so we should be able to relay those information to the relevant departments. And then when recruited, the work environment again has to be adjusted to help. I visited some departments and talking to PWDs and looking at how they work or how they get seconded from one position to another, and what position, I mean the work desk and so on, and what tools and instruments they need to help them. So the departments have been doing that, and I've been talking to department heads, and I would definitely remind them to hire more PWDs as far as possible and to provide an environment to help them.
In terms of the dissemination of messages, transparency should be enhanced. The relevant data would be made available to us and the public. So in recent years, the recruitment percentages indeed dropped, even though the absolute numbers of civil servants with disabilities hired actually went up when we look at 2018 to 2019, and the numbers went up in some departments, including the police force and disability services. So we would see how we can improve further. Through conducting studies, we can understand whether the support on our current civil servants are adequate. Some deputations recognize the internship program since the scheme was rolled out in 2019. In the last few years, more than 300 persons took part, and they were from tertiary institutes and Shine Skill Center. The heads of bureaus and departments have been monitoring the situation. At least 4 interns were hired as AOs or EO2s. This year, we will provide about 100 places, and we would match interns to various duties. In terms of promoting employment in PWDs, there are different initiatives by the government. In the second half of the year, the Labor Department will launch a new program to encourage employers to hire PWDs. And the on-the-job allowance under the Shine Skills program will be increased from 9,000 to 16,000. For PWDs, a pilot scheme would be reinforced, and a retention allowance of $3,000 would be given for those who stay beyond 3 months until the on-the-job training is completed or when they have been employed for at least 9 months. So work has been done on different areas. Thank you very much. The floor is now open for questions. If not, I will go first. Secretary, deputations touch upon many areas, but you haven't answered some of the questions. There are calls to establish a target of 2% in the employment of those with disabilities. The current percentage is 1.6%. So is there any room you can, or is there any chance you can meet the target? For recruitment exercises, such information is not collected, and the reason is fair treatment according to the government. However, if no declaration that one is a disabled person, well, according to the paper, for applicants who mention the relevant conditions or situation, then you can provide assistance or accommodation. Even though the applicants might not fit 100%, you would still recommend the applicant. So if no declaration is made or you would not collect the information beforehand, they would not be entitled to assistance or accommodation. Like we said, with a target, you can plan for it. In a planned economy, targets would be set and policies would be drawn up. Whether or not you agree to a target, how can you achieve the goal through your plans? Thank you very much. In terms of a quota system, the issue has been discussed for quite some time. Like I said in the beginning, our policy is to create equal opportunity or equal job opportunities instead of setting hard targets every year. In terms of the justifications, they were discussed in the past. In 2014 to 15, the percentage or recruitment percentage was 2%. In the last 5 years, the percentage fell from 2% to 1.6%. So there is a downward trend. This is something we must tackle and find out about. So the key is recruitment and retention. As to whether as for the possibility of more people retiring in certain years, this is something we would look at as well, and we would seek to reinforce our policies to hire more persons with disabilities. In our recruitment exercise, on the job description page, in part B of the form, we would state that the applicant can choose to disclose whether they have disabilities or whether they are persons with disabilities and the relevant extents. And if written tests or interviews are needed, whether special accommodation is needed. If we hire the person with disability, then the relevant departments would understand data. That is why we came up with such arrangement. For current civil servants, we considered carrying out studies to ascertain whether they are persons with disabilities, but then there would be privacy concerns for those who need help at work in terms of the tools and accommodation needed, then the relevant departments would grasp the information. That way, we can find out how many current civil servants are PWDs. Unless we would carry out universal surveys, but then the issues I just mentioned would be involved. Finally, in terms of planning, this is about recruitment, retention, training, and support. So a multi-pronged approach must be adopted. Thank you very much. Mr. Lam Shuting, Chairman, the government should take the lead in recruiting persons with disabilities. They must have some sort of accommodation in terms of policy, or they should give them some kind of preference. The Secretary said the recruitment percentage used to be 2%, and now it has dropped to 1.6%. Paragraph 4 of the paper mentioned that as a whole, the success rate of applicants with disabilities for civil service vacancies was 3.26%, whereas the success rate of other applicants was 4.54%. In other words, the success rate of non-disabled applicants is somewhat higher. For persons with disabilities applying for government jobs, the work is challenging. Mr. Chen Kun-chun is a member of the Hong Kong Society for the Deaf. He said that a young person who is capable wants to take up government positions, yet he ran into many difficulties. Can the government provide a greater degree of preference to various departments? That way they would have the motivation. If you say that preference would be given for applicants with disabilities who are similarly suitable to able-bodied applicants, the various departments might not agree because they feel that the PWDs might create communication issues and more and accommodation must be given. And candidates who are capable might be rejected as a result. Can the government set a hard target of 2%? And in terms of the success rate of applications, the rates should be similar. The capabilities of persons with disabilities and able-bodied applicants are similar, then the recruitment percentages for persons with disabilities should even be higher. But the figure has actually dropped by 40%. And in terms of the percentages or success rate, there would be changes every year to the numbers. Well, I'm referring to recent times, but this trend is worrying. For the assistant clerical officers, there are many positions, and as of the end of 2019, well, he's talking about a single position. in terms of the recruitment of PWDs, the recruitment percentage dropped from 2% to 1.6%. So we would see how things could be improved in terms of recruitment, retention, and work environment. Work would be done on all fronts. Would you issue notices to heads of department? Well, you refuse to set a target. Well, would you remind them of the declining trend of recruitment of persons with disabilities and the percentage of those with disabilities in the civil service has been declining? Would you remind the heads of department to hire more persons with disabilities? This is a very basic requirement. Would you promise that? Chairman, when I meet heads of departments, the recruitment of PWDs is always on the agenda. And we also have an internship scheme. Well, my question was whether you would issue notices to the heads of departments. We can certainly remind the heads of departments of such issues.
Thank you, Chair. Now, several years ago, I have talked to the Civil Service Bureau, and we have asked for opening up more posts to PWDs as well as the ethnic minorities, and not fewer than 3%. Now, I'd like to know whether the Secretary can answer this question of mine. Now, it was 2%, but now it's now a little bit more than 1%. And these PWDs, among them, how many were originally civil servants and how many are newly recruited? I give you those figures after the meeting, okay? Now, I'm asking this because some figures show that some of them are civil servants already, and they were injured during the course of work and became disabled. Now, my other question is, do you have some sort of special employment scheme for PWDs so that, for example, for any given department for the coming year, do you have special posts for special types of PWDs? Now, let's say telephone operators. If you cannot hear, you probably won't qualify. But if you cannot walk, then he or she may be suitable. So do you have such schemes? Thank you, Madam Jiang. You're asking me whether there are special posts reserved for PWDs. Now, at the moment, we do not work like that because all our positions are open to all and everyone can apply. And if PWDs apply, we will give them equal opportunity. Now, for some posts, let's say, we're not saying that there must be four PWDs, but there are posts that welcome PWDs to apply. And you have to, we note that many posts require sitting at work, doing computer work, and so on. I believe many physically disabled can handle those jobs, but when they apply, they should have a goal to equip themselves so at least they know what sort of posts can be applied by them. So, Secretary, now I think Now, as long as they reach the standard, they should be given equal opportunity. In fact, deep down in my heart, I think we should give priority to PWDs. Now, in my office, 90% of the times my staff are working sitting down. So, Secretary, can you create some scheme to allow PWDs to join the civil service and give them some hope here? Now, I understand that we have open recruitment, but if you're saying that if there are other requirements that PWDs can handle, I believe that for the Labor Department, they already have these information given to the relevant applicants, so they won't miss out. And secondly, when they apply, we already have measures in place to facilitate these applicants. So maybe my colleague can supplement. I'm sorry, the speaker is off mic. Now, the Labor Department, we have special recruitment consultants, and to provide a sort of one-to-one consultation to PWDs. We understand that many PWDs are interested in applying for civil service jobs. So every day, we advertise these posts to PWDs. So yes, I think we are doing a pretty good job there. Just one more thing, Chair. Now, Secretary, I remember about decades ago when I was at university outside Hong Kong, the government had different systems. Apart from a certain percentage of or quota to hire the minorities, they have certain encouragement or incentives. And if you reach a certain standard, you get rewarded. Now, if a certain bureau, a policy bureau, can reach a certain standard, then they will be given a bonus or a reward. Now, Secretary, I think this is important. If the government can take the lead here, I believe we can affect many private sector companies. I'm sorry, Madam Chair. I mean, it's past 5 minutes now. We have to give time to another member. Now, thank you, Chair, and thank you for the deputations and individuals coming here today. Yes, I have all along been very much concerned about how PWDs can join the government. Now, the figure now has dropped from 2% to 1.6%. So I think this is really sounding an alarm. We should be able to find out why this is the case. Now, there are things we can think about. For example, increase the job types, because right now the percentage has dropped. So can you increase more work types or job types to facilitate the PWDs? Now, I don't know how many government departments have employed PWDs. I think each department should provide a percentage as to how many they have employed. So there should be some sort of index that they must have a certain percentage of women, for example, in their workforce. So if you have this kind of index in place, then women would be given priority. Now, using the same logic, if you want more PWDs, you give them an index or a quota, let's say 2%. Now, if that is the goal you want, the government wants to achieve, so you have to consider, or heads of departments have to consider, how to reach 2% for your department. Now, on increasing job types, now we are now looking usually at a white collar work, thinking that this is more suitable. And if you look at overseas countries, they would create new jobs. I don't remember which country, but in some airports, for checking passports, all of them are wheelchair bound. They are immigration officers, and then they check passports and so on. It's a new a job type, more challenging, and it's really tailor-made for those who are wheelchair-bound, and I think that is creative. Of course, not all PWDs want to work behind a desk. Some may want more challenging or outward-facing types of jobs. Now, I have raised this in a relevant panel before, but the government has yet to really listen to this. But now we have a new secretary here. Maybe there are new job types to allow PWDs to become civil servants. Yes, thank you for your suggestions. I would again discuss with my team and follow this up. Now, we have an internship scheme, as you probably know, and they can join as interns and practice. And so even while they are studying, they would be able to understand what is required. And they also understand what is needed in a certain department. So they already have exposure here. Now, if you want to improve the quota, okay, this is what we are doing right now. We're going to encourage departments to create more internship opportunities so that each department can provide more such positions, interns, to later on become a proper member of staff. So we want to work through this internship scheme to arrive at the same goal. Now, I think your suggestions are very good, creating new job types. Now, many PWDs, working departments, now they would consider arranging them a special place of work, traffic time, commute time, and the sort of instruments or facilities that they need. So yeah, departments are already thinking about this, and your suggestion about a new job type is a very good suggestion, but we are already doing something along this line. And Mr. Xiu, please. Thank you, Chair. Now, can I ask the government, now within the civil service, what is the percentage of disabled or PWDs do you have at the moment, and what is your ultimate goal? Mr. Xiu, at the moment, we have the figure of 2018 to 2019. We have 2,881 civil servants with disabilities, but we have a total of 170,000. So the percentage is 1.6%. And this compared with 214 to 215, the figure was 2%, so the figure was dropping. Yeah, so we are looking at why this is the case. Yes, yeah, that's right. Yeah, what is the reason? Why is it dropping? Because in these last few years and in LegCo meetings and so on, regardless of their political stance, whether you are private sector and so on, we really should be helping them with providing more job opportunities. So how come it's dropping by a little bit? What is the reason? Yes, we are examining the issue and looking at how many of them are new recruits from 218 to 190. 90 declared themselves to be disabled, but compared to 14 to 15, it was 58. So the figure has increased, and now for those who are well retained, that is another set of figures we can be look at. Now, for the disabled people leaving service, the figure was high, 17 to 18. We had 200 more than 200 leaving the service by way of retirement. So we have to look at other figures as well and to see how we can do even better.
Currently, in the service or at the Labor and Welfare Department, Labor Department or Social Welfare Department, would there be any dedicated team to help these, to help match the PWDs to government positions? Within the civil service, we encourage every bureau and department to make suitable arrangements in terms of recruitment in order to facilitate the work of PWDs. In terms of promoting employment of the persons with disabilities, or perhaps I would defer to the director. Or the Assistant Commissioner for Rehabilitation. We provide support measures in terms of the recruitment of PWDs through different departments, such as the Labor Department and SWD. Support is offered or extended to civil servants. Employers would be encouraged to recruit PWDs. Employment subsidies would be offered, and we would also support social enterprises in hiring and training PWDs. For PWDs who want to find employment in the market, the Selective Placement Division of the Labor Department would provide job matching and counseling services. I believe Hong Kong people has a lot of empathy towards the persons with disabilities, but the disabilities might come in different forms. Some might be visually or hearing handicapped, some might be physically handicapped. And the different disabilities would lead to different choices in job searching. For example, the visually handicapped might not be able to read documents. For the physically handicapped or those on wheelchairs, they can take up receptionist positions. So it depends on the actual type of disability. I asked the SWD or Labor Department have a dedicated team or officer to help these job seekers. I think by appointing or assigning one officer in each department, you can help these applicants. This would be conducive to the employment of disabled persons. Administrative staff in each department would take up the work. I visited a department recently. They have staff on wheelchairs. Doors would be retrofitted so that they would be opened at the press of a button. So this involves modifications or retrofitting at different departments. We would also encourage private businesses to hire more persons with disabilities. This is done through job matching, case management, and subsidies for both employers and employees with disabilities. And we are encouraging them to provide more on-the-job training and to encourage retention. Mr. Hun Xiuping. Apologies for being here late because I have to attend multiple panel meetings. I'd like to thank the deputations for attending. The employment of PWDs would be discussed every year, and you are the fourth secretary I have worked with. The government should take the lead in eliminating all sorts of discrimination in employment. So in terms of employment of PWDs and the social service, we have been asking for a target or target percentage. The paper mentioned that when applicants apply for civil service jobs, they would enjoy equal opportunities. And according to subparagraph 3, if an applicant with disabilities is found suitable by the recruiting board to carry out the duties of certain posts in a specific rank, he or she may be recommended for appointment, even though he or she may not be able to perform the full range of duties of every post in the rank concerned due to his or her disabilities. I'd like to know how many applicants fell under this category in the past. In other words, applicants who were recommended for appointment despite the situation. According to the annex of the LegCo brief from 2013 to 18, the wastage or the number of civil servants with disabilities leaving the civil service was constantly rising. You cited retirement of about 273 staff members. With the extension of retirement age of the civil service, I wonder why so many PWD civil servants were leaving. Have you sought to understand why they were leaving? You launched the internship scheme for students with disabilities in 2016. More than 30 tertiary students have joined the scheme. Satri, you said you would you have met the interns in person every year and have received positive feedback. I'd like to know the situation on the recruitment of these interns. How many of them joined the civil service? Thank you very much. There could be different posts in a specific rank. If a candidate cannot carry out the full range of duties, he or she may still be recommended for appointment. This is our policy. In terms of figures, I might defer to my team. If not, I would provide them in writing after the meeting. As for the reasons for civil servants with disabilities leaving, retirement has been the main reason, even though the retirement age has been extended for newly recruited civil servants. And some of them resigned, and for some civil servants, their contracts were up. We would see if more details could be provided. The internship scheme has been well received by various departments. At least 4 interns joined the civil service after they completed the internship program. They were hired as administrative officers as well as EO2. As for details, we will see if anything further can be provided. Miss Eddie Chu. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the deputations for coming. I was at another meeting, so I could not follow what you said. So if the chairman allows, the deputations can respond to what the secretary just said. The paper provides broad numbers. For example, 2,881 civil servants with disabilities. What is the distribution in different departments? This might be mentioned in the questions in the budget debate. I hope the secretary can provide the breakdown by department and the recruitment figures of different departments in the past 5 years. I think that would paint a clearer picture on which departments would be more proactive. I hope such information can be provided. In terms of setting targets, the targets might not be about the absolute numbers or the overall numbers. Even if an overall target cannot be set, you can have different smaller targets. The Civil Service Bureau is the gatekeeper. When there are changes to the establishment for the Hong Kong Police Force, they have increased the establishment by 2,500 in the financial year. There are frontline offices as well as backroom staff. If a department wants to increase its establishment by 2,500, the CSB should set a target. Let's say you should at least 5% should be persons with disabilities. you can set specific targets for different departments every year. We saw new jobs in face of the epidemic, for example, attendance taking body temperatures. If there is a need to recruit in mass within a short period of time, that might warrant a higher recruitment percentage for civil servants with disabilities. That way you can eventually formulate a bigger target. In our paper and the LegCo paper, the relevant figures have been laid out, and some were discussed at the Finance Committee. In other words, the number of civil servants in different departments with known disabilities. It is somewhat difficult to provide details because the information we collected is based on declarations in the recruitment or application. And when accommodation is needed in the work environment, the request would be made. So for civil servants who do not wish to disclose the details, we won't have any information on hand.
Now, on the index, or as a fixed quota, it's not suitable because if it is a very rigid figure, and in the recruitment process, we want to recruit on an equal opportunity basis. Now, if looking at the past 2 years, okay, the figure, the percentage has dropped. We want to see how we can increase the figure. Now, I'd like to add that we already have circulars, notifications to departments to increase hiring PWDs and then to facilitate their work environment. This is something we will continue to do. So depending on the individual departments and their job types, yes, the Bureau can help them tailor-make a certain scheme. It's a flexibility. Yes, it's a kind of a soft index. Well, do you have one? Do you have any soft index? Now, at the moment, it is 1.6%. 5 years ago, it's 2%. So the figure has dropped. We want to find out where we can do better to increase the percentage. So that's our goal. And we will look at individual departments to see how this can be achieved. Now, finally, I would like to follow up on behalf of certain speakers. 2 points. Number one, now for the 2% figure, now the government has yet to follow up on this. You don't want to have a rigid figure. Now, but the trend is falling. So can you set a deadline that a kind of a minimum that it mustn't drop below, let's say, 1.5%? So that's number one. We don't want to see this figure dropping any further. Secondly, now the new position for 30,000 people, would you have a certain percentage for PWDs? Maybe it's not a hard figure. Now, in our July meeting, we're going to have a discussion on the 30,000 posts. Now, can you let them know what you have in mind? Finally, on the ADHD issue, now looking at the government figures, now within the civil service, it's listed under others, okay, autism, special learning needs, and so on. So that ADHD should be listed under that category. In fact, their percentage is pretty low. Now, among the civil servants, how many are within this ADHD category? So can we be given more information here? Okay, three areas. First of all, on whether you set a minimum percentage. Yes, we see the falling trend, and we will find out what is really happening to see how the figure can be increased. That is our goal. Now, during recruitment, we will be paying attention to this. Now, on the 30,000 temporary posts, again, we will contact the departments, but it's not going to be a fixed percentage or a fixed quota for PWDs or non-ethnic Chinese. Again, we want to engage more such people. In either in recruiting or retaining, we want to improve that figure. Now, thirdly, on the ADHD situation, now we have to look at whether it is difficult to have the correct figures, because as I said, when they apply, they may or may not indicate that they have this condition. And within the work area, they may need special help. And if they don't indicate, and if they don't have any special needs in their work environment, we will not be able to know whether they have this condition. Okay, all right, if you do have further information, we will reply to the various individuals. Now, I think the meeting has to stop here. And once again, thank you for attending the meeting, sharing your views. And thank you, government officials and NACHCO members. Meeting adjourned.